Sonia Doi is a member of the Allan Kardec Spiritist Society of Maryland since its foundation and is currently serving as president of this organization. She is also one of the founders and currently president of the International Spiritist Medical Association. Professionally, she's an MD, PhD, occupying a position of associate professor of medicine at the Uniformed Services University in Bethesda, Maryland. So we see that she's giving her time and time to come here and speak with us about this beautiful topic, evidence of prenatal consciousness. And I know you, all of you, are tired of my voice, so I'll pass the word to Dr. Doi. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'm so happy to be here. As Leo mentioned, I'm always happy to be here because we have this friendship going on for several years, probably about 20 years or so. So it's a great pleasure to be here and see you all. And I also want to ask for forgiveness for my delay. Traffic was a little worse than I predicted. Okay, so what we're going to talk a little bit about is the evidence of consciousness. And this is a topic that brings a lot of information from non-spiritist professionals. We have to start from the cycle, human cycle, human life cycle. Under the materialistic concept, the cycle of life starts here when we are born and ends when we die. So it's between the cradle and the grave and nothing else. So before we are born, materialists do not believe that there is life here. We are just a mass of tissue, of organs that are growing. But fortunately, this is changing a little bit. And it's changing already from a long time. People did not realize much. But when science asked, when does life begin? I don't know why it's not showing. Okay, there we go. Scientists, teachers, embryologists. Embryologists are the doctors that deal with the study of development of life. And the embryologists, Dr. Moore and Purcell, are very well known and respected in the area of medicine, as well as others. And I bring in here a piece of a text published in 2008 by Dr. Maureen Kondek. So they are affirming life begins at fertilization, not at birth, at fertilization. And Dr. Kondek is associate professor of neurobiology. And in this text published in 2008, she states, human embryos from the zygote stage, that very young first stage of cells getting together, forward are indeed living individuals of the human species. They are human beings. From the very first stage when the parent cells, the cell of the mother, the cell of the father get together, that's already considered a human being information. So this is a statement by embryologists. We also see, I brought here another excerpt from a text, from an embryology textbook. This embryology textbook is used by, you know, several medical schools. All physicians have to study this. They go over, but they probably don't pay much attention to it. So in this textbook, there is a very interesting statement. It says, although life is a continuous process, fertilization is a critical landmark because under ordinary circumstances, a new genetically distinct human organism is thereby formed. When they say life is a continuous process, probably what they meant, there's no explanation in the book what they consider continuous process. They probably think, you know, they probably meant it's a continuous process from fertilization, from those two cells, from the egg cell, all the way. It's a whole process. But we, as spiritists, can also consider this process. It's taking a little time to show, but here, it from the egg cell, from the very first, you know, formation of the cell, fertilization, we can also consider this continuous process from pre-birth, after birth, as our life, as a incarnate individual, and then after death. It's always continuing because we are one spirit, okay, one individual. But we're going to talk about it later. So when does life begin? If we looked at our spirit's book, question 344, Kardec already asked that question. At what moment does the soul actually joins the body, meaning when does life begin? And what does the spirits answer? They answer even more than what we learned from science. They said the union begins at conception, fertilization, conception, but is only completed at the moment of birth. That's completion. From the moment of conception, the spirit designated to inhabit a given body is connected to that body by a fluidic tie, which gets tighter and tighter up to the instant the child is born. Okay? So that's why it says it's completed at the birth. Okay? But the link is already there. The spirit's already linked to those very first cells. So that's life. That's the connection of the spirit. Okay? Now, psychologists and psychiatrists already got very interested in these concepts because of observations. They started observing a lot of things that happened during pregnancy, and then they started collecting data, and they decided to start an association, which here in the United States is Association for Pre- and Perinatal Psychology and Health. Okay? And there's a lot of psychologists and psychiatrists that belong to that. And they do a lot of studies, a lot of research. They publish a lot. And now it's interesting when we take those books and work and put together with what we learn in Spiritism. That's what we're going to do here, okay? So they do a lot of studies and observations through prenatal memories that emerge during hypnotherapy. So how does this happen? After we are, you know, become an adult, sometimes we are afflicted with some problems. Something that, you know, depression or some problem that cannot be well resolved. And the therapist sometimes go to a hypnotherapy and try to do regression, okay, to find out when the problem arise, when the problem emerged. However, in many cases, instead of going from that age to the early ages of infancy, they go to that period of gestation. And they remember things that happened during pregnancy. And many times they remember things that caused a trauma that they carried over in as an adult. Okay? So this is what these psychologists and psychiatrists collected, a lot of data that they were collecting during hypnotherapy. Okay, so they were adult or child psychologists, and when they needed to do hypnotherapy, these things start to come up, and they collect all this data. Other times they had children who had spontaneous memories. So I think we all have examples of this, right? A child, very young age, 2, 3, 4 years of age, they start revealing things. When I lived in Germany, or I was once in some city or something, they remember something. And that is very interesting because they may remember traumas or things that happened, not in a previous life, but during pregnancy. The doctors, oops, what am I doing here? Maybe I should use it. Can I use this? No, that's okay. That's okay. I'll behave. Okay. So I'm going to list here some of those psychologists, psychiatrists that were reporting cases. Were the very, I would say, important person that started all these studies, brought up these studies, was Dr. Thomas Verney. He published in 82 a book called The Secret Life of the Unborn Child because of these revelations. Although he didn't really know how that happened, but, you know, he doesn't talk about spirit or anything. He just thinks that there's a baby, the baby has life, it's perceiving things that's happening. Later, Dr. Michel Audin published a book called, also based on all this. He thought that it was very important to make parents aware that the baby has perception. So he published a book called Primal Health. And this was more in terms of telling parents, look, take very good care of what you say, of what happens during pregnancy, of the environment, because this may impact on your child later on in life. Then comes a doctor that was very important. For some reason, it's not. Maybe. There. Dr. David Chamberlain. Dr. David Chamberlain published several books, and he was very prolific. One of the most important work that he did was published in 86. It's a book called Babies Remember Birth. And in this book, he did a true research. He did hypnosis, you know, there's a patient that comes with a problem. He did a hypnosis, he collected data, then he called the mother or the father or both and did an interview. What happened to you during pregnancy? So the parent would say something and he would match what was revealed during hypnotherapy with what the mother or the father would say. So he published several cases and he says it's very reliable because he could really match things that the mother would say. I don't want to say this, I never told this to anybody, but I'm going to tell you in confidence, this is what happened. There are several cases, I'm going to bring it later. And then very recently in 2013, he published, and I'm going to bring several examples from this book, several reports of consciousness in the unborn child. It's a very interesting book, Windows to the Womb. He passed away last year. I'm doing this again. What do I do here? Okay, sorry. Oh, good, okay.
You're already there.
And then Dr. Wendy McCarthy. Dr. Wendy McCarthy was in our Spiritist Medical Congress last year, and she has a lot of data, but there is a little difference from her and the others. She already has the notion of spirit. Okay? She knows. She knows that it's not just a, like a perception. She knows that she brings the notion of spirit. And this doctor, Miriam Sergeur, it's a interesting, I put here because she has an interesting case. She has a book published, she has a book called Yes, Babies Can Talk. Talk to your baby, she says. And she's a pediatrician in a hospital in France. And she's there like, when a doctor has a problem with an infant, a newborn, she is called. And there is a very interesting case. There was a mother who was pregnant of twins, and two girls, and one little girl died a month before term. So when term comes, when the doctors did a surgery, take the girl that was alive, and then take the other girl that was dead. Okay, the girl that was alive, they were taking care of like any other newborn baby. The baby was okay, but she would refuse to nurse. She would not accept nursing. She would not accept the bottle. She would refuse being fed. So they had to put in an IV, infusion, and days start to go on, and she would not eat. She would not accept feeding. So the doctor said, she's going to die. And then is when they decided to call Dr. Miriam Sergeur, who was in the hospital where she worked. And she says, well, I can try to talk to her. And she went there, and she started talking to this baby as she would talk to any adult. And she would explain to the baby, I understand. You were for 8 months. You had your sister side by side with you. Now you don't have her. I understand you're sad. I understand you're missing her. But, she could not stay. But you were born. You have to live. But to live, you have to eat. So please eat. You have to live for your sister. And after 1 or 2 days, then the baby started eating and survived. So beautiful story. She has more stories. Now, when we look at all this research, they come to some points here. The unborn child is conscious and reacts to the environment. I think everybody knows this, right? I mean, not everybody. People who already had babies, right? The baby, sometimes you say something or you are sad or something happens and the baby kicks or turns or something, okay? So I think this is well known. The baby has several types of perception, including emotional experiences. We're going to see this. What the unborn child feels and perceives may influence his or her attitudes and expectations for life in their adult life. The main instrument of communication shaping the sentiments of the is the mother, okay? Is the mother that impacts on the baby, of course, because the baby is right there in the mother. But also, if the father is a very participating father, is a father that's, always there participating during that pregnancy, father also has a role in there. I don't want to teach embryology, okay? This is a chart of an embryology book. But this is just to illustrate from the week 1, 2, up to 38 weeks, when the baby is ready to be born, all the phases of formation, blah, blah, blah. But what I want to bring attention to is the fact that the babies could only hear through their ears after week 17 or 19. Because before that, the ear is being formed, but not fully functional. So, you know, you play a music and the baby turns and you say, oh, the baby's listening. If it's before the week 17, 19, probably not listening. And if they are listening, it's probably some vibration, not real words. Because if you have heard a person talking through some like bubble or something, you know that the voice is kind of muffled, right? So they could not really discern what it is. The other important point is that the eyes are formed by week 8, but then the eyelids are formed, and the eyelids remain shut, remain closed, until week 26. Okay? So even if you try to do something, of course, let's say physically with their own eyes, the baby could only see where it is, right? Inside of the uterus. So let's say you put a light or something there. Well, they probably could not see it before week 26 because the eyelids are closed. Okay? So I'm telling you this because of all the perceptions that have been reported. So we see through all the reports that there are perceptions before the complete development of the organs. We have also visual perceptions outside the uterus. So, you know, when they go through hypnosis, they say, oh, when I was in my mom, in the uterus, I saw that my father came or whatever. Ah, they're inside of the uterus. How could they see it? Okay? So this can only be explained by an out-of-body consciousness. So the consciousness is not through the organs that are being formed, but it's out of the body. So I'm going to bring you some types of perception that we are not really aware that they exist, and they are reported by Dr. David Chamberlain in his book, Windows to the Womb. One of them is telepathy. And in his book, this is a little excerpt from his book. He says, in my clinical experience, it's common of prenates at very early moments in the womb to sense whether they are wanted or unwanted, and by which parent. And he poses the question himself, how do they know? Okay. So he says he had many cases where, you know, the baby at that point already knows whether they are wanted or unwanted. They're rejected sometimes by their parents. And he again poses the question, how do they know? A baby in the womb sensed, and this is an example, is the baby that sensed that the sibling was kind of frightened, was kind of afraid, was kind of uncomfortable when the mother was pregnant because of the forthcoming of the brother. So it was a little girl that was, and the mother confirmed, yes, during the pregnancy, she was really kind of, you know, becoming a little insecure because of the boy that was coming. So it was reported. Now, paradoxical sight. Dr. Chamberlain says any evidence for vision during life in the womb is paradoxical because the vision of prenates is anatomically primitive and limited because the eyelids are shut until week 26. So anything that is reported that the baby saw this or that is paradoxical, means it doesn't make sense, right? So this is one example, reacting to light. So when they shed light into the uterus, the baby, and they can see this by ultrasound, the baby was frowning or turning the head against the light. But this is the most interesting report, reacting to amniocentesis. So when we put the needle inside of the uterus, the amniotic sac, to collect some material for examination, okay, to see maturity of the baby or to check for genetic diseases. And this was a case. This is not the only case. There are several cases. This is a case where the doctor put the needle to collect, and the baby would put the hand against the needle. So they pull immediately. They tried again. The hand, in any position that they put the needle, the baby would put the hand. And it took 1 hour for them to be able to collect the fluid. Okay? And this baby was, I don't remember, but was like much, much earlier, 16 weeks. So could not see it. And also, not only could not see it, but had a good reflex of where the needle was coming from. Clairvoyance. Dr. Chamberlain says that the babies have a clairvoyance perception because they see what's happening at a location out of their sight. So they report, here is one of the cases, okay? So that you understand what is clairvoyance. So it's seen outside, so it's out of the body experience. This is under hypnosis. He is talking to a person that is under hypnosis. And the person, and he says, "What? Where are you?" And the person says, "I am in a bedroom. I see a bureau. My father is there. I think he's yelling." I shorten this, okay? If you see in the book, it's a lot longer. "I am inside my mother. I can see everything from up above." Not from in here, from up above. "I see this little bassinet. I'm thinking, I don't want to come out and live with him, the father. I don't want to be around him. I feel terrible all over." Okay? So this is a case of a person who always, you know, after birth, had this rejection and had this terrible time accepting the father. And it comes from that time. This is another very interesting case. Young lady that had a very frightened feeling and went into hypnosis, and she says, "It's too sad." So she's remembering when she was in the uterus. "I was hardly formed, and my mom is using some kind of remedy to wash me away. It feels real hot. I know she's trying to get me out of here. I'm just a little blob, little mess. I don't know how, but I know. She is not supposed to get pregnant. It had a strong, harsh smell like ammonia. I can see what I was too. I was up there, just teeny. I know nobody really wanted me then, but I was determined. I was a fighter even then." So, of course, if we are seeing the report, this baby survived the attempt. So it's a tentative of abortion. Okay? Dr. Andrew Feldmer is a Canadian therapist, and he was not working in these cases of, you know, memories, pre-birth memories or anything. But the interesting point is that he had four young adults who attempted suicide at least 5 times, each one of them. Tentative of suicide at least 5 times. So he decided to go and study these 5 guys to see how come they are attempting suicide over and over and over and over again. Okay? And look at what he comes up with. He says, the doctor, "I discovered that the tentative of abortion can be remembered unconsciously, by the child and can later result in multiple tentatives of suicide. And he says, even the style of suicide mimics the style of abortion. So he says, if the mother attempted abortion with some mechanical thing, curettage or some mechanical thing, the tentative of suicide would be by a weapon. If the tentative of abortion was chemical, then the tentative of suicide would be drug. So he was able to make this correlation. How do these perceptions occur? So far, we are seeing evidence by psychiatrists, psychologists who are not spiritists, so they have no commitment to say, okay, this was a spirit or whatsoever. They are just reporting what they are collecting, right? Now, if you read the books, they do not explain how does this perception occur. Okay, there's life, but it's inside there. How this baby can have the perception? Dr. Chamberlain goes a little further, and he says there is a consciousness that is, you know, beyond the body. But he doesn't go over to say spirit. Now, if we want to know how these perceptions occur, science cannot explain yet. We have to step a little beyond what science says. And where do we go? Kardec. All the books of Kardec, especially the Spirit's book, can explain all this. But a lot of explanation come through the books written by Chico Xavier, by the spirit Andrea Luis. Okay? So I think many of you have read several books of Andrea Luis, and in this account, we can really understand how these perceptions occur. So I'm going to give you a little bit of explanation. We are the soul. We have a mental body, a perispirit. Perispirit has several layers. I also here condensed a little bit. There's more: astral body, causal body, vital body, physical body. And of course, all the memories, all the perceptions are acquired and kept by the spirit. Okay? That's how we can actually bring these memories from one life to another. Because the body changes, right? The perispirit may change a little bit, but the memories are in the spirit and kept by the mental body that connects with our brain. So that's how we bring these memories. So the soul that keeps all the memories transmit it to the mental body, which is responsible, and Andrea Luis explains this, responsible for the formation of the perispirit, molding the perispirit, will affect the perispirit. And then all this affects the physical body. So now we can understand that spirit that is connected with the body information is having these perceptions. And all these emotions, all these perceptions kept in the mental body may affect the formation of the perispirit and the physical body. So then we come with depression, with diseases, with several problems. Okay? The mental body is the subtle envelope of the mind. So it's kind of, it's where the mind sits. This is Andrea Luis saying, it is like the seed, the mental body is like the seeds that contains all the codes for the formation of a tree. So our mental body has all the elements that concentrates all the experiences and form our perispirit and our physical body. So everything is by the command of the mental body. The perispirit, we all know, is the fluidic envelope of the spirit, links the spirit to the physical body. So the memories, and this is in the book Evolution in Two Worlds by Chico Xavier, André Luiz. He says about the mental body, he says, in the biological rebirth or in the disincarnation, the mind performs an automatic and rapid review of all experiences lived, imprinting magnetically in the cells of the physical and perispiritual body the line of directions to which they will be subjected in the new cycle of evolution. Difficult to understand, but what it says is all the memories, the perceptions that were kept were in the mental body are going to be imprinted in the physical body, in the perispiritual body, and is going to give the directions to which they will be subjected in the new life, being an incarnated life or discarnated life. So that's going to kind of set our, you know, the tribulations that we may go through or the problems that we may encounter. So here is just to illustrate the body-soul connections also through a text of André Luiz. He says the cortex, so that layer of our brain, is where the energetic connection from the consciousness for the work of touch, hearing, all our, you know, regular senses are coming through energetic connections from the spirit to the cortex so that we can move, we can see, we can sense taste, vision, smell, whatever. So this is all kind of recognized and processed through the outer part of the brain. But it's in the thalamus and hypothalamus that the soul, through energetic connection works for the sensory sensations, sensory perceptions, including virtues and all the particular emotions. So it is this part here, thalamus and hypothalamus, that is responsible for our emotions. That's where the spirit, the mental body, connects through those parts of the brain so that we express our emotions or we perceive emotions. Now, we learn through André Luiz, and this is the book, if there's one book that you want to read about, you know, this process of formation of life, is Missionaries of the Light. Because in this book, André Luiz, through the reincarnation of Sigismundo, talks about all this process a lot more than I'm going to talk here. So he tells us that there are spiritual guides that are responsible for planning, preparing, and linking the incarnating spirit to that fertilized egg cell. Okay, so he explains all this process. He explains that the parents-to-be are prepared way before to welcome the incarnating spirit, especially when the incarnating spirit is a spirit that will come to reconciliate with the spirits of the parents, okay? So there is a lot of preparation. So we might see all these problems, all these tribulations, but we should be aware that there are spiritual guides working, helping during this whole process. We also understand that this planning is subjected to the law of cause and effect, that some people know as karma. And not only through regarding the physical body, the formation of the physical body, but also which family this spirit is going to be born into, which environment and circumstances this spirit will be born and live. Okay, all this is part of a planning. It's part of the evolution. But there's always an objective, and this is very important for us to understand. The object, the main objective, whatever the problem is to acquire new moral values, to evolve, especially in some cases, expiation or reconciliation. So there is always in the problems that we see, there's always an objective. Here's another revelation. And this is to illustrate, so we learn from André Luiz that there is a planning before we are born. There is an objective. Look at this report. Dr. Chamberlain was not spiritist, but look at this report. So he's interviewing this person under hypnosis, and the person says, I feel that when I was conceived, I was aware of a lot of things. I felt wise, like I knew what I was doing, like I came to that place for a reason. I felt glad I was conceived, like I chose that place, those people. I needed those people, needed their chemicals, needed to interact with them, to work with them, in making some kind of combination to make me come alive. So we see that many of the reports that I illustrated before were kind of sad, right? Mm-hmm. Traumatic. But here is a happy report, okay? And this is telling us I was aware of a lot of things. So is the spirit, is the child that's being, you know, evolving to be born, but not, you know, you think that, oh, the perception is very limited. No, it's a perception like any other intelligent being. It's not because it's a baby, but the intelligence is there, especially when it's out of the body, because it's not depending on the brain. It's not functioning through the brain. It's functioning out of the brain. So they have a lot of perception. They have an intelligent perception. I know I knew a lot of things. I came to that place for a reason. Okay? There is a reason. There's an objective. In this case, and remember when we say we choose what we're going, we ourselves plan our next incarnation. I chose that place, I chose these parents. And she even says, I knew I needed these parents. Like we understand, you know, is that bonding, is that spirit that need the parents to help them to evolve. So this is a beautiful illustration that's side by side to what we learn from Spiritism. So what have we learned from all these reports? That life begins at fertilization. We learned that there are several perceptions before birth. We have learned that perceptions occur before organs are completely formed, meaning it's an out-of-body experience. We learned that perceptions during pre- and perinatal phase can impact the adult life. And here I want to make a point. Perceptions during prenatal or perinatal. What is perinatal? It's that time when the baby is born. During the whatever room is, the surgery room or, you know, the wards, whatever. That particular time is very important. So we want to bring the awareness to doctors who are working, bringing babies, you know, to life, so that they become aware that they're just not taking a little body, putting here, there, they're following like a protocol. No, they should be aware that that's that is a body that has perceptions beyond what we imagine. So we have to be careful with what we say, you know, no jokes, no all that, okay? We have to be careful. We also learned that memories perceived by the soul can affect the perispirit and the physical body. And we learned that there is a planning based on the law of cause and effect, and there are objectives for this. Now, once we learn this, we cannot just stop there. We have to do something. We learn we are responsible, right? Once we know something, we become responsible. So, once we know this, we have to learn to be aware that we have to respect life from that time of fertilization. There's life, and we have to respect it. There's a spirit living there. Parents and healthcare professionals, beware of perceptions during prenatal and perinatal phase. This is a very, very important concept that we should pass on to, you know, young people getting pregnant, to doctors working with mothers-to-be. Make the environment as pleasant and welcoming as possible. Not only the home, but the hospital, okay, or the doctor's offices. Express love toward the incoming baby. And this is not just the role of the mother or the father. Everybody can do this, okay? So even if one says, well, I'm not going to be a mother anymore, I was never a mother, or whatever, we can always express love toward that incoming baby, okay? Because they will perceive it. Parents, talk to your baby. Talk as the baby is a child, is an adult. Okay? I had a very interesting example during a talk that I was giving in Switzerland, and this lady came after I gave the talk. She says, I had an experience to share with you. She says, I was pregnant, and it was like eight and a half months pregnant, and my husband had to travel. And I was really, do I travel with him? Do I not? What would I do? And she was really confused. It was not a long travel, but she was concerned. And then she said that she prayed, and she went to a room and talked to her baby and said, you know, I am really insecure here. I'm unsure whether I'm going to go and travel with your father or if I stay here. Few hours later, she passed blood, so she knew that she had to stay, okay? So those are things that we could say, just a coincidence, maybe not. And this is to everybody. Give support to the future parents, especially to the mother. And this is very important, especially in cases where, you know, this young adults become pregnant, be not a planned pregnancy, and we really should give them the best support so that they won't go and say, oh, I want to abort, I want to get rid of this because I cannot have it. Okay? So we all have a very important role there. We can give them support. Of course, I want to also say that all the reports that I brought here from Dr. Chamberlain and others were reports collected during hypnotherapy of adults that, you know, regressed and remember what something that happened during the time when they were in the womb. These are not really scientific in the sense of, you know, the rigorous of science, but they are reports that I think in hypnosis sometimes it can, you may be The person may be exceeding, you know, in emotion, saying things that are not absolutely what happened. But in view of so many reports, not just one or two, and by many professionals, I think we ought to give some, So, this is how we, this is at the end of Dr. Wendy McCarthy's book, Welcoming Consciousness. She has this paragraph, which I think is very interesting, very beautiful. She says, we now understand so much more about how important our role is in supporting consciousness during transition from spirit to human life. See, she already has that notion. Each of us can contribute to babies being more fully connected to who they really are and living their lives as spiritual human beings. So I think this is very interesting, very nice way of her ending her book. And we also know that the Human Genome Project was looking, you know, predicting to find probably more than 100,000 genes and only found 25,000 genes in the human being. And many of our genes are shared with rats. So we are not, you know, really. This is just to say that these 25,000 genes do not explain the large diversity of the human beings. So does not explain that we cannot be so materialist and say, okay, everything that we do, everything we think, everything we are based in our genes. It's not. And we now know this. So I like this quote very much, and I think most of you already know this quote. We are not human beings living a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings living a human experience. Who knows whose quote is this?
Mother Teresa?
Nope.
No, somebody else, yeah, but they mentioned it.
Pierre Teilhard Chardin he was a Jesuit priest, but not spiritist, paleontologist and geologist in France. And because he was studying science, he started thinking, you know, especially paleontology, he started looking at development of the human being and came to the notion that God could not have created the man like just, you know, Adam. So he says, it's more than that. He was very evolutionist at that time already. And what happened to him? Church expelled him. So he had to flee from France to China, where he did a lot more studies. But he had this beautiful quote. So I always like to bring this up. And I could not finish this talk without bringing Dr. Marlene Nobre, because through all the things that she did, the wonderful things she did, one of the causes that she fought more for was to defend life, especially life before birth. She was a great defender. She has a book that's still only in Portuguese, O Clamor da Vida, and she went in many, many places giving talks about this and really trying to influence people, especially in Brazil, influence the laws and lawmakers to defend life from conception. Thank you.
Dr. Doi, thank you again for these beautiful teachings that we received here tonight, closing also with this beautiful example of life. And It's a lot of information, isn't it? And we probably have a lot of questions too. So we would like, is it okay with you to take a couple questions, and I'll take the microphone and raise your hand, and so we can put order a little bit on the questions. And anybody have any comments, any questions? Yasko.
Oh, that's very, very compelling when you bring these memories, perceptions from the time. Science is sure we don't have organs, so something else is happening there, you know. And how, so the science, can we kind of make a parallel between this mental body where you said you store all the memories, informations up to that moment, to the whole consciousness that the science would say? Conscious, I mean, conscious, subconscious, unconscious, all these layers. Do you think it could be make a parallel with this, if we want to those more scientific people to understand our language?
Mm-hmm. I have not seen in Spirit's book a correlation between what psychology says, you know, all the layers of consciousness with what Spiritism says. What I can say through what we learn from Spiritism is that the source of perception is the spirit through the mental body. So the spirit, as we know, the spirit in our realm, and until we become a absolutely perfect spirit, we always have a paraspirit. So the spirit, through this mental body, which is part of the paraspirit, not only perceives what's going on, but they store all these memories. Now, these memories now go, when this spirit is incarnated, or make connections with the brain, right? So that's how we now, as an incarnate spirit, remember what happened here or there. We don't remember past lives. This is what sometimes we can call, I don't even know psychology much, so subconscious or other parts of consciousness. So if we want to say consciousness, consciousness is equivalent to the spirit that is perceiving things, okay? With their spirit and everything. So that's consciousness. How the consciousness is manifested, then is psychology part. In Spiritism, we know that there are memories that remain hidden, remain kind of blocked, because if we bring those memories up, that would completely mess up our plans of learning, evolving. So that belongs to stay there blocked, because otherwise we're not going to evolve well.
Thank you. Thank you. Just to add a thought to what you said, in psychology, when memories are repressed, sometimes they're repressed for a good reason, too, from this lifetime. And that when the person is mature enough, they'll recover it, because they really couldn't handle it earlier. Mm-hmm. That's just this life. I was interested more more discussion, or if in your reading, the role of the father. You cited the importance of the participating father being harmonious and supportive, and then the other example of the person having a conflict with the father. Mm-hmm. I was curious about adopted children or test tube babies, if there were any references to them.
Yes, there is. In essence, we know that the memories that were kept by their adopted child may be now in conciliation with the parents that adopt that child. So say a child had a very problematic gestation period with their biological parents, and now is adopted by other parents. And these parents are going to be loving and caring and kind of soothing those bad memories and helping. So that is something that also goes together with what we learn in Spiritism. Sometimes it's part of that plan to go through those difficulties, but then there are these, you know, saving people who are the adopting parents. In most cases, the adopting parents are parents that are extremely loving and caring.
Can the moderator also ask a question?
Of course.
And it's basically just what you were getting to right now. We acknowledge that there are great parents, and we acknowledge there are learning parents, because mm-hmm. it's a journey.
Yes,
and we also acknowledge that there are some mistakes made during those moments that you mentioned and afterwards. What would you give as in a few words, you know, as a guideline for many of us that may have experienced something, or perhaps, you know, as parents as well, you know, learning parents, you know, what we can do now that we have this awareness?
I think you read my mind, Leo, because I was actually, if nobody asked that question, I was going to bring it up, and I was here thinking, okay, don't forget, because this is a very, very important question. Of course, you know, many people are not aware of this. This actually came out not too long ago, and the books are becoming more publicized now. So once a person realizes, oops, you know, I didn't know this, so I made some mistakes. Maybe my son, my daughter now has problems because of that. There is always time to mend, because the best way of mending is love. So if you think that you had a problem, and actually during some of these talks, a person came and said, you know, I realized that when I was pregnant, I had a very difficult time. I had a very difficult time. I was fighting with my husband all the time and blah, blah, blah. And now I regret so much. Now I know, and I regret so much. Maybe that caused some trauma to my son, who is now an adult, and he never knew. Maybe some of the things that he's encountering now is due to trauma. And we said, go and talk to him. Mm-hmm. And she did. So the way is, come and say, okay, you probably don't know that, but during your, you know, the time that I was pregnant with you, this and this and this and this happened. I was very young, I was not experienced, I was undergoing a tremendous pressure, and all this happened. Now I know, so I want to tell you. And what happens is, the person says, oh, I'm so happy you told me this. I understand this, and I understand you're loving. And, you know, and it comes to so much more bonding between the parents and the child. So there's always time to talk. And the recommendation through all these psychologists is talk. Bring it up. And it's love that will mend it, love that will reconciliate. So there's always time. And the same thing I was going to also bring up is that we brought many cases of abortion and suicide and all that. And that can be a little bit uncomfortable too for some people. And the word is always, again, love. If that happened and the person didn't know, and you know, there's always, as you said, we are all learning. So there's always time to mend. And if that happens, now is a time to dedicate love to somebody else, love to a person who is pregnant, love to children who are growing without parents. There's always a way to bring this up.
Thank you so much. It was a wonderful talk, Dr. Doi. Thank you. So it would be correct for us to say that even before, or if a woman thinks that at some point in her life she would like to conceive, even as a young adult, we would say that even for herself, not even the prospective father, but for herself, she should begin to do her own process of self-love, because it's difficult to love others if we don't love ourselves first.
Yes.
So you would say even preconception years, you would say that it's important for the mother and even the father, or for a man and a woman, for us, each of us, to do already the process of self-love, analyzing ourselves, so when we get to the point of when we're ready to begin to think about being, you know, conceiving a child, we're already more emotionally mature, we've dealt with some of our issues. And this, right? I mean, is that correct?
Absolutely,
in saying that?
Yeah. That's very, very interesting and very important development before one thinks about conceiving. But I would say that loving yourself is something that we all should do, independently of thinking about conceiving or not. Because this is what Jesus taught us. Love others as you love yourself. So we have to love ourselves before we love others. So I think this is very, very important, because by loving yourself, you start preparing yourself, making yourself a loving reception for the baby that's to come. But for all of us, we should be loving ourselves.
And can I share one other thing? I remember Givaldo told a story in one of his lectures that there was a mother who had a toddler, and her daughter never would let her pick her up. She wouldn't let her do things. Every time she went to feed or bathe her daughter, she would scream. They found nothing wrong with her. She would only allow the father to do this. I mean, they went through so much trouble to find out what happened. Finally, someone said, I'll go and consult Givaldo. Maybe, you know, and she wasn't Spiritist, but her friend was, something like that. And Givaldo told the mother that Joanna said, told him, Joanna, who's his spirit guide, said to him to tell the mother that she needs to think about what she did right after her daughter was born. And she said, I don't remember. So Givaldo said, come back in a few days and come see me again. When she saw him again a few days, she said, Givaldo, I remember that right after I had my daughter, when they brought her to me, I refused her because I was so angry that it wasn't a boy or something like that, and she didn't want to, you know, breastfeed. She didn't want to do anything. She kind of rejected the baby and said, no, I don't want it. I'm, you know. So Joanna said it was that instant that the child captured that and impregnated in its memory. So Joanna said, when the baby is asleep, go to her and tell her that you accept her. After that, after a series of number of weeks of doing that, then the kid changed. So I thought that was interesting.
Absolutely. That goes exactly with what the psychologist says. That's what they call perinatal, okay? And that's exactly it. And the other important example here is go and talk to the baby. You think that baby won't understand? No, it's a spirit. It's an intelligent spirit that's there. Great, thank you.
Last question.
It's a little bit connected with what Kirsten is commenting. The new baby, the life of the new baby, will be affected when the mother has an unconscious rejection because of the previous lives. You know, so consciously the mother wants the baby, but it is an unconscious rejection there.
I don't know how that would, because all we are saying is based on reports. But what I believe, and this is me through all these studies, okay? What I believe is that if the rejection is unconscious, the mother is making the effort to love the baby, to care about the baby. the baby will not receive the rejection, but will receive the love.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Doi.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, and also we'd like to thank Zan Maria for also being with us here today, which is Dr. Doi's husband. Thank you. Okay. Yes. Teamwork, right? Teamwork. So now we are actually going to be doing a moment of visualization where we're going to close our eyes, play some soft music in the back, and tune our minds to the good and noble spirits. We have already been spiritually fed this evening, so let us, in modern day terms, allow us to marinate in this blessing of these teachings this evening. Let us get into a comfortable position where we are uncrossing our arms and legs. If we have anything in our lap, let's put it on the ground if possible. But most importantly, let us tune our minds. First, giving thanks to our Creator God, our noble Master, Governor of planet Earth, Jesus Christ, all of his noble guides, loving spirits that are here with us, joining us in this banquet of love and learning. We thank you, and we are grateful for these moments to join together freely, without fear of persecution, without fear of practicing, and learning more about this beautiful doctrine and teachings. We are grateful for our sister, Sonia, being with us here today. And we take this opportunity through the lessons we learned this evening, let us take a trip. Let us take this moment to go inside of ourselves, to go deep into our unconscious mind, where Joanna De Angelis and the prominent Swiss psychiatrists refer to as the shadows. And let us remind the part of us, the experiences we've had during our mother's gestation, during the time when our mothers were pregnant, and during the perinatal or afterbirth period. Let us remind that small child that we are loved, that we have an almighty creator above all else that loves us and wills us into existence, that wants our happiness, that wants us to see love in action in our daily lives. Let us spend time with this inner child, reminding ourselves every day that I am a child of God. I am loved and I am wanted. Let us take this opportunity to also feel the blessings of the spirit friends, the noble guides that are here, that are now showering over us these blessings from the great beyond. To all those that are present here today, feel the sensation of love, of peace, surround us. Help us to find balance. Help us to find unity with the Creator and the divine within us. Let us continue on with this thought. As we prepare ourselves to receive the spiritually magnetized water, and we thank all those for this evening, for many evenings like this, to be able to interact with the spirit realm through intuition, through inspiration, being reminded again and again of our purpose in this life, to connect with our spiritual selves and the divine within us. Let us receive the water as our dear sister Alba will be handing it to each one of us. Let us drink it with intention, knowing that each cup, although it might seem at random, each cup has within it this special water that these specialized spirits come and bless and magnetize with what we need. In order to keep the environment with this loving energy and to give to support to the work that's going on in the spirit realm, let us monitor our thoughts to keep them elevated, pondering tonight's talk, tonight's teachings, and how we can help one another, how we can help friends and people who we meet that find themselves in this position, either with a desired or undesired pregnancy. We thank you for these moments, and so be it.